be with you all.
And also with you.
I think about God's heart being great, a great big red heart.
And I know you're probably not going to get enough candy today, so I have a little bit to give you. And I wanted to give you some red candy, and it is licorice. So I think it's a little thing of licorice to think about our believing hearts and God's great big loving heart. And you can take it and you can go back to your spot. They do not have peanuts. And it's also really exciting because May's mom is there. Weston and Mia and Kylie are taking their first communion, so that is exciting too. It's just a special day. Thank you for being here on this special day. God loves you. Okay, you can go back to your spot.
Apart from works prescribed by the law. Word of God.
on page 926 of your pew Bible. The Gospel according to John, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits a sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in a household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. When I was at my first church in Iowa, I was going out to visit the people who were homebound in the nursing home. I had never met them before, and I was going to the nursing home to meet Calvin. I didn't know much about him. I knew that he was an older gentleman. I knew that he had a disability, and I knew which place he lived. And I'll never forget that I got to the place, and I opened the front door, and there was a man there at the door in a wheelchair, and I looked at him, and I knew right away that it was Calvin. And he looked at me, and I know that he knew that I was the new pastor. Don't know how we knew it, but we knew it. He looked at me and he said, I've been waiting. And then he wheeled his wheelchair around and he made a beeline for his room. He turned on the light. He pulled over one of those trays that they have in nursing homes and hospitals, you know, that are on wheels and they're adjustable. And he pulled that around and put it in front of me. He got himself on the other side of it and he sat there. And I knew what he wanted. He wanted me to set up communion. So I set up communion. Calvin, the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. I took it myself. The body and blood of Christ also for me. I said the blessing. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace. And no sooner than I had said amen, he said, "See you later." And he wheeled out of that room and he went into the commons area where he proceeded to fold washcloths, which is where I always found him after that when I arrived. And all we did when I came was have communion, and that was it. I've been waiting. I shared that story with someone later on in the congregation, and she told me a story that put a whole new meaning onto that moment. It turns out that before Calvin was in the nursing home, he'd come to church every Sunday, and this was a few pastors back, and he'd always sit in the last pew, and then when it was time for communion, he didn't come forward. And there was a new pastor who noticed that, and she asked, "Why doesn't Calvin come up for communion?" And someone who had been in his confirmation class 50 years prior remembered that when they were confirmed, and back then that's when you took your communion for the first time, was after you were confirmed, the pastor said that Calvin couldn't take it because he couldn't intellectually understand it. I've been waiting. I've been waiting and waiting and waiting. That pastor changed that right away, and from that day on, he came forward for communion. I don't know if he was able to intellectually understand it. Maybe he was. Maybe he wasn't. But he understood. And he understood more than anyone I have ever met in my life. What is it about the church that we keep putting barriers between God's love and God's people over and over again? So today is Reformation Day. It's the day, as I said to the kids, we celebrate that even though we get it wrong, God changes us so that we can welcome more people to the table, so that we can take the barriers away. And it was on this day, 1517, I didn't do the math before church, was it like 505 years ago? 504. Thank you, math teacher. So 504 years ago, 2 days the barriers of the church of his day, the barriers that were up literally between God's people and God's love. If you go to the churches in Germany that are still there, there are gates so that the laity are kept away from the holy space where communion is served. You can still see those gates. And so he had had it because he read something in scripture that showed him that you don't have to earn God's love. And he nailed his issues up on the church doors to make them public, and the Reformation started. But the Reformation didn't just happen 504 years ago. The Reformation is happening all the time as God teaches us to get out of our comfort zone and to change, as God teaches us to open the door and to see the places where we put up those barriers between God's people and God's love. And it's so cool that we are celebrating some first communions today, because communion is all about the table where God shows us God's love, right? It's such a perfect day for that. So awesome. And Jesus knew that we would make everything complicated. So Jesus gave us communion, where he promised bread and wine. I'm going to be there. As often as you eat this bread, as often as you drink this cup, I am there. So that we always have this and we offer it here in this place. So, Mia, what is the most important thing about communion? Can you say it nice and loud?
God loves you.
Awesome. Kylie, what is the most important thing about communion?
God loves you.
You got it. Weston, what is the most important thing about communion?
God loves you.
Right on, man. God loves you. This is the place and the family where we teach each other, show each other, proclaim God loves you. And then when we say our thing at the end, honor, we rejoicing, proclaiming, teaching, sharing God's love. We receive Jesus and we take Jesus out into the world and share that message. The most important thing that we need to know, God loves you. Amen. We continue with the hymn number 469. Please rise.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for your creation, for mountains, rivers, streams, cities, homesteads, and neighborhoods. Write in our hearts a new love and care for creation. Give us the will to curb wasteful habits and to hold accountable those who neglect the vulnerable. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for all who serve in public office, for wisdom and understanding upon all who govern, so that communities of justice and peace may thrive. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for all who long for healing in mind, body, or spirit. Strengthen hospitals, clinics, counseling centers, nursing homes, and recovery centers to be holy spaces of renewal that all might live the abundant life you intend. We pray especially for those we know who are in need of your care, and we name them before you now. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for all who seek to grow in faith and love of you. Take away our need to judge and exclude. Guide our congregation in setting the table of love. Bless Kylie, Mia, and Weston today and throughout their lives as they come to the table seeking your mercy and grace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks for all the saints and reformers who have gone before us, who dwell in your holy habitation. Give us courage through their example to challenge unjust systems and work toward life-giving reformation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Confident that you hear us, O God, we boldly place our prayers into your hands through Jesus Christ, our truth and life. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. And gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
And so at this time, we will begin to serve communion. The First Communion families will have the Loudon family come forward, and then we'll have the Loudon family come forward. And then after that, as I said, we will walk up for everyone else. And there is prepackaged communion here if you would like to walk up and receive it. If you have already taken it, if you're going to be taking it out of the body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you.
May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. And receive this blessing. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life into a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen. And our sending song is 826, and we will sing verses 1 through 3.